Now, last week, I did a segment on the really important union organizing drive underway at Amazon's huge warehouse in Bessemer, Alabama. And you can see my chat on that topic with Dave Mertz of the Retail, Wholesale, and Department Store Union in the archive. As you can see, all our past episodes in our archive. Please do subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can track all our episodes. This is so important a campaign, I wanted to come back to it with another segment, because a win here, the first union at an Amazon warehouse, would be a huge beginning to unionize this gargantuan corporate thug, not to mention a huge boost and message to everyone that organizing is possible anywhere in the country at any company. So workers are now voting by mail ballot, a vote that will go on until the end of March, and they are voting in the face of an ugly, vicious, anti-union campaign by Amazon. So to get a feel now for what's happening on the ground, let me welcome in Joshua Brewer, a lead organizer for the campaign for the RWDSU. So Joshua, tell us a little bit about how you got into this, maybe as an organizer, how you got into this campaign, but also a little bit about your background in terms of the labor movement.
Sure, absolutely. So I've been with the organization about 6 years, started organizing with very little understanding of the labor movement in whole, but really wanted to help people and had, I think, a lot of energy. And so they were excited about that. So they said, all right, kid, just run down to, we've got this campaign down in the panhandle of Florida. It was a smaller nursing home, a group of workers down there. And I said, well, what do I do? He said, well, you hold a sign by the front gate and you encourage workers to unionize, you know? And I said, all right, I can do that. And I called Randy about a week later and I said, hey, Randy, there's a maintenance man. He's installing a water sprinkler here where I stand. And he said, he looked at the maintenance man and said, brother, I'm sorry to do this to you, but I'm just following orders. And so they had actually ran sprinkler systems to try to run us off the gates. And so I called Randy. I said, well, what do I do now? He's got a sprinkler on my gate. He said, go to Lowe's, get you a bucket, flip that bucket upside down and sit on it with your sign, put it on top of the sprinkler head. And so that's what I did. So I went and got a bucket and I put it upside down and I sat on it and that sprinkler head shot under my feet under that bucket and I held the sign and we won that campaign. We won it 3-4-1. It's a great union now, operates great, and they got a good union contract. And so that's really how I just got my feet wet. Since then, I do represent a lot of poultry plants, some dairy production in Birmingham, some healthcare, but do a good amount of organizing. And so next was really a big campaign with Fresenius Medical Care in the South, primarily female, primarily people of color. They also won 2 elections there, and that was a few years back, and we just got them to a contract. And so, have had a few runs and dealt with a few multinationals. And so this isn't our first time going against a company with a ton of money that is fiercely anti-union. And so, we had some experience before jumping in here.
Well, that bucket over the sprinkler head is a sign of labor ingenuity and quick thinking. And I think I'm going to remember that and harken back to that every time I have a segment about labor organizing and the challenges, because there's always an easy or perhaps obvious or a very ingenious way of countering the company. I love that. Tell me a little bit about where you're from, and you're relatively young compared to me, for example. Sure. Did you do union organizing from kind of the outset, or did you do any kind of organizing before that? And where were you raised?
Sure. So I was actually I'm born in South Georgia, raised in Oakland County, Michigan. And so my mother remarried when I was very young. And so we moved to just outside of Detroit. And that's really where I spent my formative years. I was in Oakland County until I was 19 or 20 years old. Moved back down south, just different odds and jobs, tried to find my way, partied a little long from college. And then really about 24, 25, just started trying to find my way, wanted to help, had a lot of people that helped me along the way. And so started in youth ministry, actually, in Alabama here, dealing with youth. And so interestingly enough, I also say this, they say, well, how did you all organize 6,000 people into some agreement? And I said, well, I used to have to organize about 60 10-year-olds at a week-long camp retreat. And so if I can chase all of them down and we can keep them in a group, then it's, you know, it's really the same thing. And so on a much bigger scale, but, you know, dealt with youth, did some mission work overseas, in Honduras, a couple trips there, just tried to find my way, met with a man named Johnny Whitaker, actually went to church with him. He was our local president at the time in the Mid-South Council. And he said, look, man, you got to give it a shot. You know, I really think you'd like this. You've got an interest in business and you want to help people, and we need people like you. So, you know, that's really how I got involved. It was just another, and the way I see it now is it's just an extension of ministry. I think it's a very similar field. People need help. They need advice, and we've got some good answers for them. And so, you know, I see it really paralleled pretty much the same.
That's wonderful. So, okay, the ballots are out in the mail and workers are now having a chance to cast their ballot for or against the union. What's the vibe right now on the ground, if you can give us a sense of that?
Sure. It's a fight. It's a fight. There's no doubt about it. It's exciting. Depending on the moment of the day, we feel like we're absolutely going to win. We're going to run right through it. And then sometimes, you know, it's an emotional roller coaster. Amazon has done, they've done a number, you know, for those that are familiar with labor process and labor law, they really had a 2-month head start as we were beginning to gather cards. And before we had access to employee information, and we were really able to reach the majority of the employees outside of just trying to get them on the gates and through community organizing, they were already doing a full-fledged anti-union campaign with captive meetings and inoculating people into these really misinformation and twisted kind of facts that they, well, twisted lies that they call facts. And so, you know, it's taken a lot. Once we were able to have access to the workers' information, like phone numbers, email addresses, that we were able to start putting that good information out there to everyone. And so we're really seeing the momentum shift, because I think a lot of workers are saying, okay, I spent 2 months hearing from Amazon and now I'm really hearing from the union, and I'm starting to look at this thing. And I think they're seeing where a lot of the stuff Amazon told them is not adding up. And I think there's a lot of now skepticism forming around a lot of the things Amazon was saying that is now being proven to be really untrue, and not just untrue from the union's perspective, but from the media and the general public and all this support, the overwhelming amount of support that they're seeing and feeling in the last few weeks as this has really, you know, captured the nation's attention, at least for labor and the economy. And so they feel that, the workers feel that, and they feel that momentum. The organizers feel the momentum on the gates. The folks on the phones, you know, we at this point, our staff has expanded tremendously from labor all over the country helping out, and our own staff. And so, you know, they're feeling it on the phones. And so we feel really good right now. We feel excited, but we definitely are in a fight. You know, it's Alabama, and this was never going to be easy.
So you mentioned a couple of things just now that I want us to spend a little more time on, and that is the nature of how hard it is to organize. And you sort of said Amazon had 2 months to prepare and go after people and quote unquote inoculate them, which is beat the crap out of them and completely propagandize them. And organizers have to get people at the gates and or track them down at home. And so let's make an analogy, which I made actually last week when I talked to your colleague, Dave Mertz. Let's say there were two people running for president of the United States. And one person, let's call it Mr. Amazon, got to campaign and talk to every single voter face to face inside the United States. And then on the other hand, the opponent, Ms. RWDSU, had to do all his or her campaigning, in this case, Ms. RWDSU, her campaigning, say from Mexico or from outside the country, and had to try to reach all these voters without actually knowing where they lived or being able to reach them on a day-to-day basis. My point is that the analogy here is really, really important to understand that it's so hard, and yes, there's so many obstacles for the union, first of all, just to interact and get the information to people.
No, that's 100% right. And I think it's I'm with you 100%. I think it's actually, when we look at addressing labor law in this country and how do we give really workers their freedom back to organize? Because if you look at the national polls, if you look at really any sort of studies, workers want unions. They just can't get them. And so, you know, we have to address that. And I think when you look at Europe and you look at some of these countries with larger unionization rates, you're seeing access. You're seeing laws that provide access to the union to be able to have a fair election. And I think that you're 100% accurate. And so, you know, the way the federal labor law system works is we had to provide legally 30% of the 6,000 workers signing authorization cards in order to begin the process, right? Even at that point, that just began the process. Now Amazon has the ability through a broken labor law system to jam this thing up for months and months on end in that very beginning process, which they attempted to do. And we had to make some legal strategy decisions in order to avoid those costly delays, because anytime you have a movement, there's excitement and there's a movement and a moment in time that you have to capture. And so Amazon knows that, and Amazon and any other major company, their first goal is to delay, and stop the vote from happening. And so, look, Amazon tried that. We were able to get past that. Even through that process, we did not have access to employee information. And so when
and
you
the
really
delays think- always use the delays always are to the advantage of the corporation, obviously, because there are some people who are really committed, the organizing committee, the people that really want the union. But a lot of people are sitting back and saying, you know, yeah, I'll support the union. But then when delays come and then delays on top of delays, they start getting concerned that ultimately what they need and what they want won't come to pass. And that's where the real challenge is for union to keep folks together in the face of this relentless effort on the part of the company to bludgeon people, delay, and frustrate people.
That's exactly right. And it's even more frustrating because during the summer months and fall months, as we're building committees and community organizing and talking to people, we're showing them labor law. And so they have this expectation of what's going to happen. And then when they get into the fight and they see corporations get to break those laws and really just ignore them with very little punishment. And, you know, in this country, we do not do civil punishments. We do not put any sort of labor violators in jail or things of that nature. I know the president has talked about looking at some of those things in this administration. I think they're important. I think there should be some repercussions to violating federal law. You know, I know a young lady right now in my mind that I had a conversation with this 17 years ago. She was falsely accused for a bad check for $91. She was given a felony at that time in a public defender. And that felony is still on her record. She didn't write the check. She has an alibi. She can show where she didn't do it. It was at a pet food store and she doesn't own a pet. And so, but for 15 years, that has prevented her in many ways from having the careers that she wanted. It has been a stumbling block for her. And when you look at a multinational company, where you look at a campaign that people are saying has economic implications for the entire country, and then you allow those entities to just break laws and do it so openly and brashly with zero repercussions, I think that alone is just a social construct and a national problem. Right.
And when they break labor laws on top of that, they're breaking safety and health laws. So in this country, if you kill somebody out in the street, even if you run them down with a car, you will go to jail for a very long time. Right. If a corporation and a CEO kills a worker at work, they will essentially get off with a slap in the wrist. There might be a financial fine, that's just basically deductible by the company. It's a cost of doing business. But none of these CEOs ever go to jail, no matter how many workers are killed, how many workers get sick, and how much damage they do to workers' physical lives. And that kind of leads me to a question. Let's get down into the weeds here about what's happening at this warehouse. What's been the safety and health record here? Because I know from looking around at Amazon warehouses, not just in the United States, but around the world, Amazon has a really piss poor record when it comes to safety and health.
They do. Actually, generally three times the national average for significant injuries. And so, you know, when I would say local facility, we deal with, you know, a plethora of people that are on leave, on medical leave, that are either coronavirus or workplace injuries, repetitive motion. I would say that as a local warehouse, I wouldn't be able to say that it's any worse or any better than the other Amazon fulfillment centers, because those numbers, Amazon is very much lock and key with a lot of this information. I would say though, that when you have a worker working at the pace that they're doing, on 10-hour days, which is their primary concern, is that we have a 10-hour work shift and we're getting 2 30-minute breaks. Well, some people say, oh, well, so do I. Okay, well, but let's just talk about this. Most of us don't stand on a line for 4.5 hours a day and pack and rip and pull and move constantly, very, very rapidly on our feet, right? So you then get done with your 4.5-hour run, you get this 30-minute break. Well, keep in mind, Amazon fulfillment centers, including this one, are up to 16 football fields in size. And so the scope for people is hard to imagine. I mean, it's hard to imagine a warehouse that houses 6,000 workers, not including contractors. There's probably 7,000-8,000 workers in the building. And so you can fathom this size. And so the workers say, look, we walk 4 football fields to our break station. We get there, we sit down, we go to the vending machine, get a water, go to the bathroom, we sit down, and we have 7 or 8 minutes to eat something. And we've got to start the journey back across that monster facility to our workstation. And yeah, so—
And they don't even have regular, normal pee breaks. I mean, let's face it, you can't time the moment when you're going to need to use the bathroom. And if you have to hold it in until your break, first of all, that's medically dangerous for a number of people. And then to your point, and I've seen this in other warehouses. I remember a story of a warehouse in the UK where literally to your point, where someone would be stationed, it would take them that long just to get to the bathroom, quickly use the bathroom, and then get back to where they were because they were on the other side of the warehouse.
That's right. That's exactly right. And you know, what is mind-boggling is that Amazon is aware of this. They could fix this. They could do very small things just on this issue alone, but they refuse. And that has been their history. They're not going to listen to, they don't want to listen to labor. They don't want to listen to public perception. They don't want to listen to OSHA. They don't want to listen to the Senate, the Congress. They feel truly, and they act as if they are larger than us. And I think for people watching and paying attention to this campaign, that should be one of the most important parts of this campaign, is that there's a large portion of this country that is not able to speak out against Amazon. You look at their sheer size and the fact that they're now infiltrating digital media, movies, production, retail, food, business. It begins to get very worrisome, right? There's a reason why we have laws in this country to protect against these kind of things. And we've seen that on this campaign, you know.
And let's underscore the point that Amazon could do all this because it is owned by the richest person on the planet. Elon Musk might have passed Jeff Bezos briefly, but let's face it, Jeff Bezos is richer than most human beings who have ever walked on this earth. By the way, he's not rich because of me, because I refuse to patronize Amazon until they're a union company. And certainly for other reasons, Amazon destroys local small businesses, as you well know. But the point is, they could do small things and they can afford to do that. They have a huge amount of money. They have a huge amount of cash. They're making money hand over fist, including during, as you know, during the pandemic when people are stuck at home, their profits and their revenues have gone sky high. So this is just about the amorality of this company. And I assume that most of your workers know at least a part of that. And that's what I want to kind of move to is sort of, did workers come to this organizing effort knowing sort of what Amazon's impact was generally on workers? Was it a personal decision on their part because of their own circumstances, or did they see also as well? Some saw it as a bigger movement.
I think it's both. So I'll start with, first of all, I think workers came to us knowing Amazon's history, but I think also workers came to us just disappointed. I think they were very excited when they heard that Amazon was coming to Bessemer. I think the economic struggles of Bessemer has been widely reported. And so to have an employer come in and offer $15, which as we know in the South is a more competitive wage, certainly than we're used to seeing with some of these smaller factories and plants. So they felt excited about it. I think what workers found when they got there was the opposite. I think they found mass chaos. There was quite a few water issues when they first opened the facility. There was issues with the internet, which everything runs off of an application, the Amazon A to Z app. And so there was issues with clocking in and out, and workers weren't being paid correctly. And And ultimately, it was this underlying concern that we were being treated less than human, that we don't have a supervisor or a manager that we really know. We have pictures of them on our phone, but we've never met them. And that ultimately, we feel like we're losing a sense of our humanity. We report to this robot, to these robots that give us these directions. And when we have issues or just regular questions, you know, especially with COVID, I mean, we were in an administration that was giving no one any answers. There was a lot of confusion. And these workers were opening and starting this work at the exact same time. And they felt like they would reach out to Amazon. They would ask them questions, you know, basic things. What do I do if my spouse is COVID positive? Am I supposed to come in? I have no symptoms. Am I going to lose my job if I don't? And so often these questions just went unanswered. And so, you know, I think you spoke to it. Amazon has the ability to fix some of these issues if they truly wanted to, but they don't. And they are choosing to open these facilities in places where they know workers will need the wage, where they know workers will put up with a lot of the nonsense. And it's intentional. And I think, you know, I think workers were aware of some of the past, but we're certainly not aware of the bigger picture here as far as labor goes, right?
So one of the things you mentioned about inside the warehouse, give us a sense. I gather that what you said when you mentioned that workers don't see their managers, don't know who they are, their pictures on a phone, that folks can be working in this massive 6-foot football field size warehouse, as you mentioned, and they might not see anybody who is their partner from a sort of manager standpoint. They're working alone, pulling this stuff and answering just to a robot?
Well, that's all right. So there's so much going on, and there's an application, and then they have the robotics. And so often they're told to message HR or set up an appointment if you need to speak to anyone with human resources or with your manager. And again, these were the complaints where they said they would just go and answer. They would send the email, they would try to schedule the appointments. Nobody would come. Next thing you know, you know, your disciplinary paperwork is also delivered on the app many times. And so there's a thing called TOT time, time off task. And that's the other large issue at Amazon that they're refusing to acknowledge. And that is essentially everything at Amazon, as we know, is incredibly automated. From the time you click buy to the time that product shows up at your house, you know, it's Henry Ford, you know, mass 80 years forward, right? And so there's a very, very, very distinct way that this assembly has to happen and that these things have to go. And it's all very tight in time.
And very impersonal and sterile and probably quite alienating. I can't think of a more alienating environment as you've described it. And that must have contributed to folks talking to each other and saying, there's got to be a better way. We have to be treated with some dignity and respect. We have to have some rights, which it's one reason Amazon has assiduously, aggressively fought any attempt to unionize. And let's talk a little bit, give us a couple examples about what Amazon has been doing to destroy the union movement.
Sure. So, you know, they started with captive meetings very quickly. And to give everyone an explanation of captive meetings, it's essentially a meeting where they have their employees come in, they pull you off the line, pull you off of your job, and they bring you into these meetings that they call classes. And they're led by anti-union consultant lawyers that are paid very well to essentially manipulate information and misinform workers and try to prevent workers from unionizing. They're generally very versed on labor law. They know exactly the line that they can go up to and generally not cross. Now, that's not to say they won't cross it. They absolutely will cross it. Back to our earlier conversation, if they feel like they're losing, they'll cross it just because there's no real punishment to stop what's going on, and they'll take their lashings later.
Let's be clear what the line is so my audience knows, and that is, they can't threaten to fire you if you join the union. There are a few things where the line is drawn. And your point, I want to underscore, the cost of that, the penalty is tiny, so they will often do that. But let's be very clear about what that line is.
Sure. So number one, you're looking at interrogation and coercion, right? And so generally speaking, the board says, look, this needs to be a free and fair election.
That's the National Labor Relations Board.
National Labor Relations Board. they say, you know, look, this is supposed to be a free and fair decision for the workers. And so the union, you're welcome to explain why you believe they should vote yes, why you believe they should unionize. To the same point, the company, you're allowed to do the same, why you believe they shouldn't, if that's your opinion. But what we cannot do is obviously intimidate workers. We cannot coerce them or harass them and essentially offer them maybe benefits in the future and you know, really just to keep things fair, as if any other election, any other real election in the United States that we have. And so, you know, I can give an example, if you'd like, of a really common sense way that union busters will lie without actually legally lying.
Give it to us in a small nugget.
Sure. So best way I can, essentially, right? So once the union wins, once the workers vote to win and form their own union, they're going to bargain a contract, right? And after that process, the mass of the Amazon facility, all 6,000 workers will vote on whether or not they want that contract. And that will be their decision, and it will be voted on and won by a majority. And so what Amazon union busters will say is they will say things like, you know, the union, they can go into negotiations and they can sacrifice your wages and create language that then gives that money over to the union, and so that they can spend it however they want, right? Now, is that statement false? Technically, could we say we're gonna take money from employees and give it to the union? Theoretically, legally, yes, we could. But would 6,000 employees ever vote for a pay cut to then in turn give their money to the union? No.
Well, there's certainly what Amazon does, as we kind of wrap up our segment here. Amazon does what all companies do. I want to underscore this. This union busting process is a huge multi-billion dollar business. This isn't just some fly-by-night operation. These are highly paid consultants. They're at almost every major law firm in the United States, and they get hired by companies to do exactly what Joshua is saying, which is to skirt the line of what's legal, threaten folks, put the fear that if they vote for the union, it'll be a bad outcome. And then if by chance they cross the line, the penalty is so small, it's really a cost of doing business, especially for a huge company like Amazon. They're happy to break the law if it means that they might pay $10,000, $100,000, but at the end of the day, they stop the union. I want to wrap up with this question.
Sure.
So how are people feeling? And I want to be clear, it's not like Las Vegas where we're going to bet on how the outcome is, but give us a sense of what you think the mood is now in terms of the vote count, how people are feeling. Are people energetic? Is the feedback coming back from workers and you get a sense that people are really voting for the union?
Sure. Yeah, I do. You know, we're talking to workers every day. We're having hundreds of conversations a day. And so we have a feeling, we have a really good feeling on the campaign and the pulse of the folks on the campaign. And look, our committee, our people are saying they absolutely believe we're going to win. We're looking at our numbers and looking at the workers we've talked to. We are growing more confident by the day. But what I will tell you is, you know, we're in a fight as this whole conversation is gone. To put a fast number on that, one union buster, this just came out, Amazon is paying $3,200 a day for one person. You can imagine how many of those folks it takes to union bust a 6,000 worker plant. And so that's public information. And so, you know, we have a fight against us. They're going to spend millions of dollars to misinform and harass and terrify their own employees. But we believe the spirit of Bessemer is going to come through, and we believe we're going to win. And we're excited and looking forward to the next 6 weeks.
And the reason they're going to spend millions of dollars, let's be clear, when you guys win, that's going to set a shockwave, not just through every single Amazon warehouse, but through the entire labor movement that has been trying to organize these big retailers like Walmart, the big anti-union ones. And I think that this is why this is such an important campaign. And I really, you know, on the behalf of all the labor movement, want to thank you and the work you're doing and all those workers who are standing up in the face of this assault by one of the most amoral companies, and I've been around a while, one of the most amoral companies that I've seen and run by one of the most amoral people, the CEO, Jeff Bezos. It's one of the reasons I don't patronize Amazon. I will if they start to let the folks have a fair shot at unionizing. Joshua, thanks very much for being on the show. We'll have you back to update us as we get closer to the vote.
Sounds great, brother. I appreciate you having me and appreciate the work you're doing getting the messages out. Thank you, brother.